As we do know right now, cases as confirmed here in Ghana stands at 287. Now, let's do a quick breakdown of what we do know this 287 to consist. In total, we're talking about the surveillance contributing to a low over 230 as we have it, and yielded about 287 so far of it. 256 Greater Accra leads with that, and currently 49 out of this 287 total case we have been discharged to go home for treatment. Now, after that, we have 228 who are responding to treatment as well, and that looks good. This is how the picture looks like. And those who are fully recovered are 3, and we still have 5 there. So out of that 287 total figure, this is the breakdown of how the picture really looks like. But one of the real issues with related to what happened earlier today from the Information Ministry and that particular breakdown is the age bracket and the persons in terms of the age and the sex who make up this 287. Now, you see the number of cases here and also the age group. 15 to 24 recorded just a little higher, but if you look at 25 to 34, you see that bracket actually recording a very, very, very high figure there. And most of it, the orange bar on this bar graph represents the males and the blue represents the female. You see between the age of 25 and 34 age group, there's a high number of male who have tested positive. If you move on to 35 to 44, you have the same, the male dominating that particular age group. The same can be said to 45 to 59 and then 60 plus as well. That's how the picture looks like in terms of the age breakdown. Now, the real concern is what exactly could really be contributing to. Let's get some perspective to this. And Dr. Augustina Silverkin is joining us via Skype. She is a researcher at the Kumasi Center for Collaborative Research, one of two institutions that's testing this whole coronavirus here in Ghana with Noguchi as well. Doc, as always, it's always a delight talking to you this evening. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, we see the demographics in terms of the age breakdown. We see a lot of male being tested positive out of the 287, much more than females. Could there be any scientific reason for this, per what you have been observing in your research?
Thank you very much, and a very good evening to your cherished viewers and your listeners. Indeed, it's quite interesting to make such an observation regarding the age groups as well as the sex, in terms of males some way somehow being at a very high risk for this particular viral infection. And I don't think this is so surprising, because actually it follows the global trend. So if you look at the global picture, you realize that more males, even when it comes to those who die or the number of deaths, you realize that about 2.8% of them tend to be males, whilst just 1.7 tend to be female. So it sort of follows the global picture. I doubt if there are any genes that predisposes men to having this infection, but I am of the opinion that maybe it points more to a behavioral attitude, how men behave vis-a-vis how women behave, because even when you go to our typical secondary schools, you see the way women keep to themselves when it comes to, I'm not by this saying that men are not, you know, interested in hygienic precautions or safety measures, but you see how women, when they have to wash their handkerchiefs, when they have to be dressed up and things like that. And really, even currently, even though we have been asked to ensure social distancing, I mean, sometimes you find men walking about, some of them playing football. So I think it's more of a behavior than strict. These are just my personal personal views.
So it's more of a lifestyle, you know, issue than scientific. Yes. But there's another aspect of this development. Over the last 5 or 6 days, the cases that we've recorded have had people who did not have any contact or have any contact with any person with symptoms or actually confirmed case of coronavirus. And what that means, that there could be some asymptomatic persons walking about who have the virus but don't know about it. Should this inform any change in strategy as we speak?
And indeed, this is what we have been preaching about this community or local transmission. And usually, this is what drives the transmission of these so-called smart viruses. So that some people may be in the community or communities harboring or incubating the virus, actually shedding them when they meet with other people in the community and spreading the transmission of this particular virus. I think that's how come now we are doing enhanced aggressive surveillance, contact tracing, and also encouraging people who show up with the signs and symptoms of this particular infection to call the hotlines and indicate the sort of signs and symptoms they are showing up with. So it is not surprising. But then it is so difficult even getting the numbers of community transmission cases from the infographics we presently see. It is so difficult. But if we are able to disaggregate the numbers and actually know the actual number of community or local-based transmissions, then we may be able to ensure some or incorporate some few mitigation strategies. And already I may be looking at right. The same enhanced surveillance, but on top of that, it may be important to enhance education as well. I mean, whether for males or community or imported cases. I think so far, our education probably hasn't gone down very well with our populace. Mm. So we may now want to do some enhanced education, and we may want to tell our population, our community members, why we are even expected to be washing our hands. Why, for example, we are not expected to be touching our faces? Because so far, the adverts, the right. media, what is usually trending is don't wash your hands, don't touch your face. But I guess it will now be very important for us through education say that, look, the virus can only get into your lungs or right. into you through your mouth, through your nose, through your eyes. So that is how come you do not have to touch your face. And great. I guess we can use a lot of people to do this
exactly.
Education for us. We have right. our national service people sitting at home. We
exactly.
have the NACOP people. So I guess we need every single hand on deck. And look, we can
right.
the government can decide to purchase some megaphones. Put
and
them
be able to distribute
vehicles,
them.
Go about and do all the education we expect to hear.
Great point that you make there, Dr. Augustina Silverkin. As always, thank you so much
for
the contributions that you make to this. Extremely grateful. She is a researcher at the Kumasi Center for Collaborative Research.